Good day and welcome back. In this video, we're going to talk about satellite motion in a circular orbit. It is also something familiar for KSSM students. We're going to review again on those formulae related to the motion, such as the speed and the period of circular motion. First thing is about the formula that you can use to solve those questions. From the last few lessons, we have learned how the centripetal force exists when the object is moving in circular motion. So our satellites are also moving around the Earth in a circular orbit. This is possible because of the gravitational force acted on the satellite, which serves as the centripetal force for the circular motion. Hence, gravitational force is the centripetal force. We can equate those two equations, and we can derive the linear velocity of satellite in a certain orbit is square root of gm over r. Based on the equation of g equal to gm over r squared, the linear velocity also can be expressed as square root gr. In chapter 5, we also have learned to derive using the formula of linear speed v equal to 2 pi r over t. Substitute in the formula, you can get the equation of the mass of planet is equal to 4 pi squared r cubed over gt squared. From the equation, it is found that the square of orbital period is proportional to the cube of the radius of the orbit, and this is aligned with the Kepler's third law which you have learned in SPM. To conclude the question for this topic, I believe those three equations are the basic and important to be remembered. The rest can be obtained through derivation, which depends on the question. Let's try one question from trial paper of KELANTAN in 2022. A satellite of mass 200 kg is in circular orbit at an altitude 2000 km above the surface of the Earth. We are given with the radius of the Earth, so always remember how you get the distance, also known as the orbital radius. It is the sum of radius of planet and the height from the surface. From the information given, the orbital radius here is equal to 2000 plus 6400 equal to 8400 km. First question is to determine the period of satellite. From the equation derived just now, we can rearrange it to get the expression of period and do the calculation. The period is equal to the square root of 4 pi squared r cubed over gm. In the end, the period is equal to 7,644 seconds. Next is about the speed of the satellite. We also have obtained the formula just now. First is the square root of gm over r, or it can also be 2 pi r over t since we have calculated the period of the motion. Putting those values, the speed should be around 6,900 meters per second. Now, we move on to revise about the types of satellites that we have. It can be either geostationary or non-geostationary satellite, which can be differentiated by the period of circular motion. One important thing to take note, geostationary satellite, or also known as synchronous satellite, will stay above the same geographical location on Earth. It is mostly used for communication satellite that we need them to stay stationary in relative to us so that we can maintain the distance for a stable connection. For Earth, it rotates about its axis with the period of 24 hours, so the satellite also must have the same period to stay at the same geographical location. We review a question from Past Year in 2020. Which statement is not true about the geosynchronous satellite? Answer C and D are true. Answer A may not be accurate since it rounds off the value if you convert the 24 hours to second. But let's check on the answer B. It says that the satellite can be placed in any chosen orbit depending on its size. Recall back the Kepler's law or the formula we derived just now. The first point is that the cube of orbital radius is proportional to the square of period, while other variables are constant. The M here is the mass of the Earth, so the size of satellite actually doesn't affect the period of circular motion. The second point is, if it is a synchronous satellite, the period must be fixed at 24 hours, which means the orbital radius is also a fixed value. In short, answer B is not true that all geostationary satellites are staying at a certain orbit. Next, we are going to talk about the energy of satellites. We have learned about the potential energy of a satellite in the previous lesson. In space, they are also moving with a certain velocity which brings the kinetic energy half mv squared. If we refer back to the previous derivation, we also can express kinetic energy as half of gmm over r. To cut it short, satellite in space consists of potential energy and also the kinetic energy. The total energy could be derived and it is equal to half of the potential energy as you can see from the derivation. Let's study about one question from Passer in 2019. A satellite of mass 1337 kg is initially orbiting the planet Mars at an altitude of 45,000 km. Then gradually descending to a lower altitude of 316 km above the surface of the planet. So from here, you should already understand how to get the orbital radius that it is equal to the radius of planet plus the height from the surface. From the question, we can quickly obtain two radius. One is 4.839 times 10 to the power 7 meter, and another is 3.706 times 10 to the power 6 meter. So the circle is descending, which means it is moving nearer to the mass. Let's calculate the potential and the kinetic energy. Refer to the initial position. The satellite has potential energy of negative 1.18 times 10 to the power of 9 joule and kinetic energy of 5.92 times 10 to the power of 8 joule. When the satellites move to the orbital radius of 3.7 megameter, the potential energy has decreased to negative 1.54 times 10 to the power of 10 joule. The reason behind has been explained before this. The work to move the satellite nearer to the planet is actually negative and it caused the loss of potential energy. Next is about the kinetic energy. As you can see that the new kinetic energy is 7.72 times 10 to the power of 9 joule, which is higher than the old kinetic energy. This could be explained by stronger gravitational force when it is nearer to the mass. It must move faster, else it will be pulled toward the planet. Overall, you can calculate the total energy yourself that the total energy is decreasing when the satellite is descending to a lower altitude. To illustrate the changes, I've placed a graph here and you could check on the formula and the graph for each of the energy yourself. Before we end, there are two more things for us to go through. First is the weightlessness, which defined as the apparent loss of weight. This is happening when there's no reaction force acted on the object, such as during the free fall motion or when you are in space. You can recall back the case study on the lift. When the lift is going down, since the reaction force is equal to W minus MA, we will feel to be lighter because of the reaction force is smaller than the actual weight. So when the lift is in free-fall motion that the acceleration is equal to G, the reaction force is zero and you will not feel any weight that you may float in the air. So the next term is about the escape velocity, which you also have learned in SPM. It is the minimum velocity required to escape completely from the gravitational pull. The derivation is based on the conservation of energy that kinetic energy will be converted to the potential energy. Equate both this formula, half mv squared equal to gmm over r, we can get the equation of escape velocity is the square of 2gm over r, which is also equal to square root 2gr based on the derivation in earlier of this video. So I think we don't need to discuss further about this. If you have any question, leave it in the comment section below. So that's conclude my discussion today. Do leave a like and subscribe to my channel. I will see you in my next video. Thank you.